Hello and welcome to the January 2023 Longevity Review, presented to you by the Canadian Longevity Association, a federally incorporated nonprofit whose mission is to accelerate the introduction of effective longevity treatments and to ensure their free availability to all Canadians under the healthcare system. My name is Chris Linnell, and I am the founder and president of the association. We are a volunteer-run organization and are just starting out, so could certainly use your help regardless of your skills or time availability. If you'd like to help us achieve our mission, then please fill out our volunteer registration form, which you can see here, or you can contact us via our website, Facebook group, Twitter, or our freshly launched public community Discord server, the invitation link which you can find here. If you click on this, I'll take you to this page. You can accept the invite, and this will take you, this is now going through to my sort of admin view, but on the Discord server, you can find all of our posts, these reviews, anything we post on Facebook, or indeed this YouTube video you are watching now, as well as on Twitter, and eventually when we get our Instagram account up and running. But there are various chat rooms, which are currently empty because we are only launching this today. But you can speak in either English or type in either English or French, and it will automatically translate because, after all, Canada is a bilingual country. And hopefully this will provide a better platform for communication or sort of discussions, which are difficult to be had if they're just comments underneath a Facebook post or Twitter or anything like that. So hopefully this will prove useful and another means of contacting us and also finding out for you to find out more about the CLA. I should just mention a big thank you to our volunteers, Brian and Miles, who are instrumental in getting this up and running. Okay, now moving on to the meat of this review, which is actually all about the latest developments in the longevity field. And although I am very interested in cutting-edge science, such as partial epigenetic reprogramming or senolytics or gene therapies and things like that, I'm equally interested in actions we can take today, which can sort of help bridge us to that sort of bright and glorious longevity future which awaits us. And in that vein, this month, I'm looking at some, I'm focusing on some interventions which are potentially available for us to take today. And the first one is a four-drug or a four-supplement combination for Alzheimer's disease. And if you've watched any of my previous videos or read any of my newsletters, you'll know that I'm very for combinations. No single drug is going to radically extend our lifespans or our health spans. It's only through the judicious combination of effective drugs that we will see something effective, basically. Anyway, this first study involved, as I say, four supplements: L-serine, NR, which stands for nicotinamide riboside, NAC, and L-carnitine. And let's take a look at this study. So these were called combined metabolic activators. And this is a relatively small study, 60 patients in total, 40 in the treatment group, 20 in the control group. And it only took place over 3 months, 84 days, as they call it. However, there were some substantial improvements to cognitive function using the ADAS assessment scale, cognitive subscale score, which after 84 days or 3 months showed a 29% improvement. Now, granted, the placebo group saw a 14% improvement, but this was an improvement over the placebo control group. And not only that, but various other parameters improved. There was improvements in the brain metabolite and protein profile, and cortical thickness improved, and hippocampal volume was maintained. But let's take a look at Yeah, you can see here, I should also mention that there was greater improvement shown to people who had initially worse scores. Now, the ADAS cog scale, sort of reverse scale, a higher score is worse, a lower score is better. And when they stratify them of a score either above or below 20, whatever that means, those who had a lower score to start with, actually there was improvements in the placebo group as well as, on the left is the treatment, on the right is the placebo group. However, for those who had worse cognition to start with, the treatment group showed a lot better improvement compared to the placebo group, which did not change. And go further down. That's all about the metabolites and stuff. But here, looking at making this a bit larger, this is showing sort of hippocampal volume. Left is the treatment group again. Right is the placebo group. And gosh, it's hard to make out here, but this line across here shows the initial volume. These are sort of four different parts of the hippocampus. And it appears that whereas the treatment group sort of maintained the volume, the placebo group, it decreased. Again, these are preliminary reports. I'm not sure this is a cure for Alzheimer's, but I should say that NAD levels and improved, no doubt due to the nicotinamide riboside, and glutathione levels also improved. Like glutathione is the body's primary antioxidant, and so its increase is a good sign. And one thing I should also mention is that the doses were quite high. So we've got 12.35 grams of L-serine, 1 gram of nicotinamide riboside, 2.55 grams of NAC, and 3.73 grams of L-carnitine. Another reason this sort of study stood out was, again, because of nicotinamide riboside and NAC, or N-acetyl L-cysteine, as its full name is, or also other supplements which are being used for longevity purposes. So again, it's just interesting to see their combination. Sticking with drug for sort of mental health or cognition, I guess, is an interesting observational study on lithium. Now, lithium isn't only found in our phone batteries or car batteries, but lithium is also used for certain mental disorders, such as, I believe, bipolar and disorders such as that, where I believe it is a sort of used as a mood stabilizer. However, some interesting findings have been noted where, lithium can also be found in drinking water. And there have been a couple of studies out, one in Japan, I believe, the other one, I think, in Texas, where they looked at the levels of lithium in drinking water and compared it to the mortality statistics of those areas, and they seem to find a correlation that the higher the lithium content of the drinking water, the lower the mortality rate was. And also there's a study, which you can find linked here, show that whereas it didn't increase mouse lifespan, it did increase mouse health span. Anyway, this new study involves data from the UK Biobank, which is a huge, large observational study in the UK involving over 500,000 people, which who are being tracked over 15 years now. And lots and lots of different biomarkers are taken. And it's a real sort of world-class study or world-class resource for other researchers to use and to interrogate. And in this study here, because there's so many people in the overall study that they can sort of slice it and dice it many different ways. And in this one, they managed to find 276 people taking lithium for a disorder, and 552 people who were sort of the matched controls with similar condition. And they found that the people taking lithium had a 3.641 lower chances of dying at a given age. Compared to users of other antipsychotic drugs. So, well, that's sort of quite interesting. And if we go down, look at the graph. Yeah, so you can see here, the black line are users of other psychotic drugs, whereas the sort of orangey line going down here are those people, all the way around. So the orange line showing the steeper mortality curve is the other antipsychotic drug users, whereas the black line is those people taking lithium. And you can see that they, at all stages, had a sort of a lower mortality rate, and I guess sort of therefore higher life expectancy. So just interesting sort of real world. I mean, correlation does not imply causation, but at least some more evidence that lithium can be useful. And there are some supplements out there which do contain lithium. And also there's some other studies I remember where lithium was used in combination with other drugs to extend the lifespan of flies and worms. But it's sort of interesting how these sort of observational studies can match up or corroborate sort of studies in model organisms. And another observational study is our next one, and this one involves people who take PDE5 inhibitors. So the most famous of which is that little blue pill you get spammed a lot, at least I get spammed in the email, for Viagra. And of course, Viagra was first developed as a cardiovascular disease medication, and before they discovered its sort of unique side effects. And it works by, I believe, increasing nitric oxide, which helps relax the blood vessels throughout the body, not just in male genitalia. But in this study, they compared people who were given prescriptions for Viagra for erectile dysfunction, compared to those who also had ED but were not given Viagra, and they found that there was firstly a 13% reduction in major adverse cardiovascular events, and also overall mortality was 25% lower. Also, there was even a bigger difference between the the top quartile of users and the bottom quartile of users. So can we, let's open a new tab. Here we go. Here, yeah, you can see, so on the left here is the MACE of the major adverse cardiovascular events, and on the right here is overall mortality. And you can see the orange line. Oh, I see, I can go even further in. The orange line is the are for those who are unexposed, as they call it, to PDE5 inhibitors, and the blue line is those who are taking Viagra or similar drugs. And you can see here that it's the orange line is below the blue line. And looking at people who actually did take the Viagra equivalent drugs, those who took the were in the, as I say, the highest quartile, well, you can see quite here how there seems to be a sort of a dose response curve. So on the left here again, it's adverse cardiovascular events, and on the right is mortality. And again, seemed to be the more Viagra that was consumed, the lower the mortality rate, or the lower the major adverse cardiovascular events. Now, of course, I should mention, I mean, I also should mention that, yeah, this came all from a US claims database with something like 70,000 people. And so quite a large, well, here we can see 48,000 unexposed, 23,000 exposed. So this thing exposed is not quite the right word, I think. Anyway, so quite a considerable number of people. But I mean, there could be a lot of confounding factors. Once again, this is observational, and correlation is not causation, but it seems to indicate that these drugs could reduce mortality, I guess, through improving your cardiovascular system. Whoops, can't close this. Hold on a second. Here we go. Close this one. Well, yeah, so again, these two observational studies don't prove anything, but it's again, it seems to indicate that there are drugs out there which have added benefits, and especially in regards to mortality, which of course is what we are after. Now, moving on from sort of human studies, and again, in all my reviews, if they are if the study is starred, there has a star in front of it, that means it is a human study. Those without are not. And this next one is a study in mice, but it is also involving a supplement that is readily available in your health food store, Genistein, which, or Genistein, I don't know how it's pronounced, which is originally found in soybeans and other legumes, and actually coffee as well. And here they found that in male mice, at least, it increased mean and maximum lifespan by 10 and 9 percent, respectively, and also improved the inflammatory cytokines, sort of the inflammatory signaling molecules, and those benefits to the gut microbiome. There we go. Just make this bigger. So here in oh yeah, the interesting thing about this is that they rather than giving the mice the drug when they were very young, they only started on the drug when they were 18 months old, which is again fairly old for a mouse, early old age for a human. Because that's when people are most likely to start taking these drugs. And you can see here that the control is the purple line on the left, and the Genistein taking mice is the green line, sort of pushed out the mortality curve. You can see the plotting there of when all the mice died. And also it improved the sort of frailty score. Purple once again being control, green being Genistein, and it worsened. Well, the control mice had a faster worsening frailty score compared to the Genistein mice. It helped maintain their body weight, which tends to reduce when the mice get older, and also maintained their fur coloring and fur glossiness and tail stiffness, or lack of tail stiffness, though it did not reverse anything. You can see the pictures there. I guess the control mice look like they're graying or losing hair more than the Genistein mice. And another interesting aspect of this study, as I say, it improved the gut microbiome. They also carried out a study whereby they basically gave some mice the Genistein, and then did a fecal transplant, just trying to find it now. Did a fecal transplant to progeroid mice, which are mice which have accelerated aging and die quite quickly. And I think if there's a graph here showing, oh yes, I believe this is it. So yeah, they basically gave the mice a fecal transplant, and also they gave a fecal transplant from the old mice who had been on Genistein. Also, another group gave a fecal transplant from old mice which had not been in Genistein, and the fecal transplant from the old mice who had not been on the drug is the sort of the left purpley curve here. In the middle is the control and the sort of a sham treated mice, and on the right are the mice who were given the fecal transplant from the Genistein mice. And yes, they lived longer as well. So clearly Genistein also helps by improving our gut microbiome and reducing dysbiosis. And I think it reduces gut permeability as well, and increase the microbe diversity. I should say again, like a lot of these studies, there is a small number of mice used. I think only 24 in the Genistein group, 29 in the control. So it's a small study. Be interesting to see if this can be replicated, and or if the ITP, Interventions Testing Program, the gold standard in lifespan testing, could maybe try out this drug, see if they can replicate these results. But again, this is found in our food and a readily available supplement should you choose to sort of go down this route. I should always warn, I mean, I try to emphasize human studies because at the end of the day, we are not mice. And unfortunately, treatments which can work in mice don't always work in humans. But that reminds me, there was a human study in Alzheimer's. Came out in November. And it showed, what did it show? Yeah, so we report that Genistein treatment results in a significant improvement in 2 weeks. In two of the tests used, dichotomized, whatever these two tests are, and a tendency to improve in all the rest of them. And this was a small study taking 120 milligrams of Genistein for 12 months in 24 prodromal, which is, I think, early Alzheimer's disease patients. But so it seems to show efficacy in humans for Alzheimer's. And that gives a little bit more credence to this, gives a little bit more credence to the translatability of this mouse lifespan study. And again, 10% or 9% isn't a huge amount, but again, given it late in life. So which is important for our perspective. And finally, from in the in this month's roundup, I included a paper which unfortunately is behind a paywall. It wasn't at the beginning, but then when I was putting this together, it was now behind a paywall. So you only see the abstract, but you can also see lifespan.io's analysis of this paper. And this paper is a follow-up paper from the most cited paper in the longevity field, which is 2013's Hallmarks of Aging paper, which basically, where's the nice pretty image? Basically divided aging into sort of nine discrete indications. So these nine hallmarks here, we can maybe make this bigger. So being genomic instability, telomere attrition, epigenetic alterations, loss of proteostasis, deregulated nutrient sensing, mitochondrial dysfunction, cellular senescence, stem cell exhaustion, and altered intercellular communication. So it's showing how aging can be split into sort of discrete afflictions. I don't know what word to use there. Anyway, it's been 10 years since that paper was published, and the same authors have now published a follow-up. So I thought that was worthy of inclusion. Now, in the follow-up, they've sort of added three new hallmarks, which are chronic inflammation, disabled macroautophagy, and dysbiosis. And I'm just taking, I won't go into detail here because you can take a look at lifespan.io's analysis. Oh yeah, here's the sort of classic chart of the original nine hallmarks of aging. And it talks about, again, I'm not going to go through all this now. You can read it yourselves, but it explains the changes which explains what the original hallmarks are and also the changes have taken place. And again, since that was such a seminal paper, I thought I would include this follow-up here this month. Okay, now moving on to the supplemental section, there are a few more papers I want to briefly touch upon. And again, hopefully papers, studies that you can take home, so to speak. And the first one involves astaxanthin, which is found in microalgae in the ocean, and which shrimp and salmon eat, which causes them to turn pink. And that sort of pinkish color or orangey pink color is astaxanthin. And it has been shown to improve sort of exercise endurance. There's a study last year, it showed it improved endurance in older people. And in this study, they have supplemented some obese men with it. And of course, obesity can lead to accelerated aging. And they got them to do sort of high intensity functional training and also take astaxanthin. They were taking, those who took it, 20 milligrams per day. And again, won't go into the details here, but basically, sort of their fitness improved, as did their lipid profiles and their metabolic markers, and also their body composition. And although that improved for the participants taking both just astaxanthin and just doing the training, as it says at the conclusion here, these benefits were greater for men with obesity in the TSG group. That's the training and supplemental group. So astaxanthin seemed to show a added benefit. And again, not aging per se, but just showing its potential benefits in exercise and sort of physical benefits, which again, older people who don't have the energy to do much exercise. Anything that can get them to do more exercise for longer periods is certainly beneficial. Again, this sort of ties, I'm just pointing this out because it ties in with some other studies which have come out before. Now, this next one, just brief take a look at, is about curcumin. So that's the yellow-orangey spice. So it's found in the yellow-orangey spice turmeric, found in Indian curries and such like. And it's been studied for quite a while. So we've reached the stage where there are enough studies for sort of meta-analyses of various sort of smaller studies to come together and get an overall analysis. And this is exactly what this study is. It's an umbrella meta-analysis of randomized clinical trials, sort of profiling the inflammatory biomarkers. And lo and behold, they basically found out that there were 10 studies in total, 5,870 participants in total. So again, usually these studies are small and each individually doesn't sort of tell you enough because they'll tell you much because they're not statistically significant. Once you put them together and you get a bigger number of people or participants, like, you know, almost 6,000 here, you start being able to tease out or reach statistical significance. And what they found out sort of ties in with prior studies that, I say, various inflammatory markers such as C-reactive protein, CRP, IL-6 or interleukin-6, and tumor necrosis factor alpha, TNFA, alpha, again, markers of inflammation, they all decrease following curcumin supplementation. So that they say here, greater effects on CRP, TNFA, were evident in trials with a mean age of people, basically people who are 45 years old and a larger number of participants. So again, just showing that curcumin does seem to be effective in people for inflammation. Though it's not very bioavailable. If you do take turmeric on its own, make sure you combine it with pepper, because that improves its bioavailability. And there are various nano formulations out there now, which improve their bioavailability, though they are sort of more expensive. I've not tried them out. I drink a sort of a turmeric drink every day because it's so much cheaper. Anyway, carrying on. Oh, yes, quick, although nicotinamide riboside appeared in the first Roundup article as part of that four supplement combination. Here's another study which has come out in January involving nicotinamide riboside, again, an NAD plus enhancer. A lot of focus has been on NMN, but I don't want to sort of throw NR out into the cold. But this was a twin study, twin pairs, supplemented with escalating doses of NR from 250 milligrams to 1,000 milligrams a day. Excuse me. And NR, basically, the results for NR improved systemic NAD metabolism, sort of increased NAD levels, muscle mitochondrial number, myoblast differentiation, and gut microbiota composition in both co-twins, and also showed a capacity to modulate epigenetic control of gene expression, muscle, and adipose tissue, which is fat tissue, in both co-twins, though it did not change the their fatness or their metabolic health. Again, just sort of pointing out, you can delve into that more if you want. And got just a few more studies to go. And yes, as I say, as I talked about at the beginning, I'm all about combinations of supplements are the way forward, and they are our path towards enhanced health and longevity. And the first paper is looking at the combination of sirolimus, otherwise known as rapamycin, which you know is one of my favorite I say the drug most ready for longevity drug most ready for prime time, and metformin, the anti-diabetes medication, which is also sort of indicated for potential longevity enhancements. And one issue with sirolimus, rapamycin, is like one potential side effect is dysregulated glucose metabolisms, or basically rising glucose levels. And when I did my little trial last 3 month trial last year, I also found that towards the end, my glucose levels seemed to be sort of rising. And I'm actually going to be doing a glucose monitor again next week to see if they've now come back to normal. So we're just slightly worrying, though that maybe doesn't affect rapamycin's longevity benefits. But ideally, you'd like to have not only have the longevity benefits, but also keep the glucose under control. And a couple prior studies have shown that a couple anti-diabetic medications like metformin and also our carbos can basically prevent that from happening. And this this study here in mice leads further evidence towards that, where basically by combining rapamycin, as I say, it's called sirolimus here, and metformin, I got rid of that. So it says here, treatment with sirolimus caused elevated blood glucose and insulin levels, which were restored with sirolimus and metformin combination. So, yeah, it seemed, and if we look at the, Look at these little chart here. The left one is glucose concentrations. Gray is the control. Red is the rapamycin. Blue is the metformin. And green is the combined metformin and rapamycin mice. And this increase for some of the mice. There's still some increase in the combined treatment group, but much less than in the rapamycin-only group. And similarly for insulin levels, whereas metformin increased, it seemed to increase insulin concentration, rapamycin decreased it, the combination kept it similar to controls. So again, this study is just showing that the combined treatment of rapamycin and metformin is beneficial. And so the next time I try rapamycin, I will be combining it with either metformin or our carbos. Now, next one, second last one we're going to look at is a review of the potential. It says here, synergistic supplementation of NAD plus promoting compounds as a strategy for increasing health span. So basically, it looks at, if you are taking an NAD precursor, such as NR or NMN, this review is looking at potential other supplements you can take alongside your NAD precursor, which might potentially show some synergistic effects. It's not showing results. So it talks a bit about NAD metabolism and all that. And but then it goes through various drugs, which or various supplements, which might be synergistic. So resveratrol, carostilbene, which I take along with my NMN, mentions CoQ10, coenzyme Q10, which I've actually started taking recently, betaine found in beets, flavonoids such as quercetin, fisetin, luteolin, astaxanthin, lycopene, which is found in tomatoes, curcumin, ones we've mentioned already, alpha-ketoglutarate, and epigallocatechin. Gallate, which is the main beneficial ingredient in green tea. But anyway, interesting if you are taking other supplements or you're wishing to combine them with NMN. it's a review. It's not providing new information, but still an interesting read. And finally, just want to just briefly mention, going all the way down to skin and beauty, and just mentioning, first time I've seen this, that they've used a skin cream or skin ointment, as they call it here, which had a probiotic in it. Probiotic being, sort of bacteria. We normally like you find probiotics in yogurts and stuff. So you'd advertise that for your gut health. And this, anyway, they just wanted to point out that they have it here for lactic acid bacteria, Lacti planti bacillus plantarum, was used in a skin cream or a skin ointment. And it improved dermal density, skin hydration, skin firmness, and skin elasticity. And supposedly the clinical evaluations of crow's feet and smoothness and various things like that also improved. So I hadn't seen that before for a skin cream. And let's face it, at the end of the day, not only do we want to live longer and be healthier when we are living longer, but also looking good when we are healthily living for longer. Anyway, that brings to a conclusion this month's review. Any questions or anything you have, I'm more than always happy to answer any of them. So you can maybe use our Discord server to get in contact and ask some questions or your thoughts about this newsletter. Again, any thoughts about this newsletter, please comment in the below this video. And please also have to say, of course, give us a like, and please subscribe to our channel. Anyway, without further ado, it's time to say goodbye. So until next month, hope you stay healthy, and again, and live long and prosper, something along those lines. Anyway, take care. Goodbye.